When he was a Labour MP, John Woodcock was on the hard right of the party. He was chair of the Blairite Progress Group until 2015, and between 2011 and 2013, he was chair of Labour Friends of Israel. He was also one of the party's most vociferous opponents of Jeremy Corbyn. In the run-up to the 2017 election, Woodcock said he couldn't vote for his own party, blaming Corbyn's opposition to nuclear weapons. In 2018, Woodcock was back in the news for different reasons. The Barrow MP was suspended from the party after sexual harassment allegations from a former member of staff. At the time, Woodcock said he did not accept the charge, but knew the complaint must be investigated thoroughly. Later that year, he left the party before any investigation was complete, saying he didn't trust the party's processes to not be biased. But sitting as an independent, he still had things to say, like this in 2019.
A government that is struggling to govern and a leader of the opposition and shadow chancellor who I am afraid to say I have not changed my view that they are simply not fit to hold high office. The public, Mr. Speaker, deserve so much better than this choice in the broken political system that they are being given. They deserve leadership to right the terrible injustices that have been inflicted on our communities.
John Woodcock there complained about Britain's broken political system, but he went on to campaign for Boris Johnson to be Prime Minister in 2019 and was then rewarded by Boris Johnson with a peerage. That doesn't sound like fixing Britain's political system to me. It sounds like taking advantage of Britain's fixed political system, right? It's rigged. Woodcock then got another job from Boris Johnson, now with the title Lord Walney. He was appointed as the government's independent advisor on political violence and disruption. It's unclear what Woodcock's qualification for that job was beyond hating the left, but he's now released his long-awaited report on political violence and disruption. And he's summarised his recommendations with an op-ed in The Sun on Sunday. I suppose it's the home of political extremism, so that makes sense. Lord Walney, we must stop thugs threatening democracy and ban MPs working with groups behind Palestine marches. So in the piece, he says this: my review on political violence is about to be formally submitted to the Prime Minister and the Home Secretary. In it, I am asking the leader of every mainstream political party to take a zero-tolerance approach to the menace that is threatening our democracy. So Rishi and Keir should instruct their MPs and councillors not to engage with anyone from the Palestine Solidarity Campaign until they get their house in order and cut the hate from their marches. The same goes for hardline environmental groups like Extinction Rebellion and Just Stop Oil, whose tactics can be to create illegal disruption to get noticed and get their way. While painting people who want to prevent a genocide in Gaza or tackle the climate emergency as dangerous extremists, John Woodcock's article made no reference whatsoever to the far right. It wasn't mentioned. He was hired to bash the left, and he is going to carry out that job, as I assume Boris Johnson intended. Of the recommendations, The Guardian write this: the proposals are politically convenient for the government because, if accepted, they would put further pressure on the Labour leader over his party's stance on pro-Palestine demonstrations. Several sitting Labour MPs have attended Palestine Solidarity Campaign events, including the former Shadow Chancellor, John McDonnell, and the MP for Poplar and Limehouse, Absana Begum. Labour has refused to suspend MPs who have attended events, despite demands from senior Tories, because the PSC is not a prescribed organisation. Unsurprisingly, Sunak is said to be seriously considering Walney's proposals. Imagine that. You've got an ex-Labour MP, campaigns for the Tories, gets rewarded with a job from the Tories, has now published an incredibly authoritarian set of recommendations that would just, by chance, be incredibly advantageous to the Conservative Party and, you know, disadvantageous potentially for the Labour Party, but obviously very, very damaging for the movement that wants to stop a genocide in Palestine. Oh, and by the way, he used to be chair of Labour Friends of Israel. Ash, is John Woodcock the most dangerous man in Britain?
Here's one of the things which I find not funny ha-ha about John Woodcock, but it's one of those mirthless chuckles that you give when you consider the absurdity of the British political system. I don't think you can get a better example of someone who has entered the House of Lords because of a fundamentally broken system. I think that he's the best example you can get of that, because as you said, here's someone on the right of the Labour Party who was being investigated for allegations of sexual impropriety, allegations which he denied, but of course the investigation couldn't be completed because he quit the Labour Party before that could be done. He's rewarded for his attacks on Jeremy Corbyn's leadership with a permanent seat in the House of Lords. He will have that role in Britain's legislature until he dies. And he's seen as some kind of hero in the eyes of much of the press, as a man who takes a bold stance against of extremism and stands up for the politics of the centre. This is a man who stands up for no one but himself. And I have a feeling that one of the reasons why John Woodcock gets such an easy ride from the press is because look at who he's married to. He's married to Isabel Hardman, who is a political journalist. She writes for The Spectator. She's very, very well liked within the lobby. And I'm not saying that she's got any particular reason to be disliked. Every time I've encountered her, she's been perfectly courteous and kind. But I think that that means that John Woodcock gets protected within that political journalism culture of we don't go for one of our own. Right? Because he's the husband of one of our own. And we really do quite like her. And, you know, she's gone through a hard time and she writes very openly about her struggles with depression. So we're not going to go for this man who quite simply has been rewarded with a seat permanently in our upper house and has dodged a proper investigation over very serious allegations. So there's something about John Woodcock where even before you get to this role that he's playing, which is trying to curtail legitimate, lawful and democratic participation in politics, that I just think he is the most perfect emblem of a dysfunctional and corrupt and corroded political system. You think about the role that he's playing now, where I think that he's trading on his status as a former Labour MP to give a veneer of liberal progressive cover to what are deeply authoritarian and draconian suggestions. And I think that is something that makes him more dangerous. I mean, look, the targets that he's chosen, Palestine Solidarity Campaign, Extinction Rebellion, these are associated with the left and they're associated with Muslims. Those are, of course, the perennial political targets of the right in this country. Those are the people who are considered to be most politically threatening to the interests of those in power. Not threatening in terms of the actual harm they pose to, you know, the population, but politically threatening to the interests of those in power. That's why they went for Jeremy Corbyn. And that's why they're going for these pressure groups now. And, you know, if we had a political media that was doing its job, I think you would have much more robust scrutiny of John Woodcock, but you don't get that because one, his interests align with the interests of many people in political media, and two, he's married to one of them. Oh, and you want to know the icing on the cake, Michael? Isabel Hardman wrote a book saying, why do we get the wrong politicians? Why do we get so many bad MPs? I was like, girl, the call is coming from inside the house. It's labeled husband.
I'm not even going to try and add to what you've said because I think you have put fantastically how John Woodcock sort of represents everything that's wrong with politics in this country. But this is such a dangerous proposal, right? Now, there are moments, you know, sometimes I have disagreements with people in the Novara office because, for example, you know, when if the government talk about saying, oh, we should tighten the law on sort of people blocking roads or whatever, you know, some people think, oh, that's a sign of like creeping fascism. I'm like, well, to be honest, if people are blocking roads, you know, it's not a sign of fascism to say, we're going to change the law slightly so we can get you out of the road quicker. You know, you agree or disagree, but to me that's sort of, you know, I think it's within people's right to take direct action. It's within the right of politicians and the public to say, oh, we want to move, we think we haven't got the balance quite right. This thing that was, you know, somewhat legal, we're going to make a bit more illegal. That kind of stuff is, to me, as I say, you can agree or disagree, but it's not that worrying when sort of disruptive, extremely disruptive protests are somewhat curtailed. But the idea that a politician, a democratically elected politician, shouldn't be able to talk to anyone associated with a political issue or a particular issue is so authoritarian, so authoritarian, right? The idea, if you are an MP, you can't talk to anyone who is part of the biggest movement in this country against, you know, potentially the worst genocide of the 21st century. You can't even talk to them because some people are holding some banners on a demonstration that you don't like. That is so authoritarian. Because also, we need to remember, when people are talking about these demonstrations against a potential genocide in Gaza, they're not disruptive demonstrations. If people were bringing London to a standstill and sort of blocking roads all the time. Again, agree with it or disagree with it, but I can see why, you know, you might say, oh, we should change some laws here because people are getting too annoyed that they can't get to their work on time or whatever like that. Disagree or agree, I don't think it's outrageous. But the idea that they're holding banners we don't like, they have political positions we don't like, and therefore they shouldn't be allowed to do a perfectly non-disruptive protest, and they should be banned from, or MPs should be banned from speaking to them. That is just completely next level authoritarian, right? And hopefully it's going to be too authoritarian even for this Tory government, because I do think that it might be the case that lots of people are like, this John Woodcock guy, he is nuts. Right? This is clearly vindictive, right? He's written an article about political extremists where all he mentions is people he's hated his whole career. People on the left, and as Ash says, Muslims, right? So, I mean, he'd probably dispute that he's hated Muslims his whole career, but he clearly hates people who are pro-Palestine and want to campaign against a potential genocide by Israel. He was chair of Labour Friends of Israel, right? It's not a surprise that this is happening. This is clearly a politically motivated guy. He does seem to be too extreme for the Labour Party. So the Labour Party has been awful on Palestine and protests, but they aren't quite as reactionary as John Woodcock. This was Shadow Education Secretary Bridget Phillipson, who was asked about John Woodcock's proposals on the BBC.
MPs need to take care in terms of the associations that we have with individuals or organisations. But I do think, however, it is important to stress that the right to protest is an important fundamental right in our democracy. That does mean that people will take part in marches or protests where politicians might not agree. But that is the beauty of our democracy. That's something that I think is really precious.
That was Bridget Phillipson being bland, but not completely evil. In contrast, Jess Phillips has actually been genuinely good on this. She said this on Sky's Electoral Dysfunction podcast.
I don't think it's a fair reflection of reality. I get, as somebody who has faced security threats for now nearly a decade, I mean, the decisions like that weren't made during Brexit because of security risks against us. I think making out like it's worse at the moment and this idea of mob rule, I can't help but feel that that's because some of the people who are upset with us at the moment have got brown faces. Like, I don't think that was the speaker making that, but this conversation that's come out of what the speaker did all about security is, I have to say, I've been a bit shocked by it.
That was quite refreshing from Jess Phillips. Ash, were you pleasantly surprised by that intervention? I suppose she could have stood up and said it in Parliament, which maybe would have been a bit, you know, braver than saying it on a podcast. But, you know, decent analysis, I thought.
Look, you do get politicians saying insightful things when the truth lines up with political expediency. So it was refreshing, but I think Jess Phillips is also, she's a canny politician. She also knows she's got a, you know, pretty high percentage of Muslims in her constituency. I think she knew that she would be subject to a, you know, potentially competitive independent run at her seat. And she's been fairly consistent, I think, on the Palestine issue since October the 7th. She, of course, resigned her role in the government so that she could, you know, vote in favour of a ceasefire. How much does that reflect her personal beliefs? I mean, it probably does. I think it also lines up with what the political pressures are for her and her in her particular constituency. I think when it comes to Bridget Phillipson, I think that again shows you the impact of the Rochdale by-election result and the polling that Labour is getting, suggesting that seats which should be absolutely nailed on for them in the next general election might not be because of how unpopular their positioning over Gaza has been. So I think that that's why you're seeing this, you know, completely rare once in a blue moon phenomenon of politicians speaking the truth. It's because domestic political pressures have spooked them a little bit.
I think that's true. And I mean, it is, you know, because Jess Phillips does have a large proportion of Muslims in her constituency. What she doesn't have is a large proportion of radical Islamists. And I think what that speaks to is the fact that when you've got, you know, John Woodcock sort of blowing these dog whistles, etc., people know what he's doing, right? People, ordinary Muslims around the country who care about Gaza, know that he is trying to demonize them and trying to categorize them as extremists and trying to clamp down on their rights to be full participants in society. maybe she genuinely believes it. I think she probably does. You know, she sounded very genuine there, right? But as you say, Ash, I think it's this question of someone's beliefs aligning with political expediency clearly has happened in this case. And that's because Jess Phillips knows that the majority of her constituents, when they sort of see this ridiculous moral panic that's going on, when they hear proposals such as this from John Woodcock, they see it for what it is, which is an Islamophobic dog whistle. You know, it's not the case that sort of these things are being said by these right-wing politicians. And then you've got this tiny minority of extremist radical Islamists in the country sort of saying, oh, damn, they're really going to clamp down on us now. All of these plans that we had to do radical Islamism and to do sort of violent threats against people, this is suddenly going to be stymied by this plan from John Woodcock. Damn, they've got us now. You know, that's not happening anywhere. What is happening is that ordinary Muslims are saying, why are they coming for us again? And, you know, Jess Phillips recognizes that because, you know, she's probably a bit more in touch with ordinary people in this country than John Woodcock is, sitting in the House of Lords, married to his political journalist, saying we need to fix the British political system while accepting a peerage, while accepting a job from a prime minister who he campaigned for against his own party, right? Despicable. But yeah, some people are seeing through it. If only more people would. And if they said it's, you know, not just on a cozy podcast, but sort of stood up in Parliament and said, by the way, this whole thing is ridiculous.